Then the black captain rose in his stirrups and cried aloud in a dreadful voice, speaking in some forgotten tongue words of power and terror to rend both heart and stone. Sometime after Sauron seized the rings of power in the sack of Eregion, he gave 9 of them to mannish kings, sorcerers and other warriors. With the power of their rings, the 9 achieved glory and grew wealthy, but they eventually started hating life as they were slowly drawn under Sauron's dominion. In the end, they all became the dreadful Ringwraiths. The one later known as the Witch-king was one of these, likely one of the unnamed 3 lords of Numenor to take the rings. He first appeared in the stories as the Ringwraith in the Second Age. Being the most powerful of the Nazgul, he became their chief and most feared servant of his master Sauron. When Mordor fell in the Second Age after the Battle of the Last Alliance, the Nazgul vanished into the shadows and were not heard again for a long time. More than 1,000 years later, in the Third Age, Sauron began to rebuild his power in Dol Guldur. 150 years later, his Nazgul also reappeared and the Witch King established his realm, Angmar, in the north. His capital was Carn Dûm on the northernmost peak of the Misty Mountains. He summoned men, orcs and other creatures of evil to his banner. No one actually knew that he was actually a servant of Sauron. Meanwhile, the Dúnedain of the north began to decline, and they eventually broke into 3 separate kingdoms, Cardolan, Rúdar and Arthedain. These 3 kingdoms were constantly fighting each other, and so the Witch-king saw the northern kingdom of Arnor as more vulnerable than the south kingdom of Gondor. He played upon their opposition, sending in infiltrators and taking over the hearts of men of that land. By 1349, the government of Rúdar was controlled by men secretly in his service, and he secretly aided them in the wars against the other kingdoms. He then struck at a time of great hostility among the 3. Rúdar in the east fell first, and most of the Dúnedain there were hunted down and slaughtered by sorcerers. Cardolan was ravaged, and the tower of Amon Sul, held by the men of Arthedain, was placed under siege. King Arvelek I was slain and the tower was destroyed. The Witch-king continued to press the men of Arthedain, laying siege to Fornost, and he might have taken over all of Arnor in that one offensive, but Arafor, the 18-year-old son of Arbeleg, came to leadership and, with the help of the ancient elf Círdan of Lindon, repelled the Witch-king's forces at Fornost. Elrond bore an army of elves from Rivendell and Lothlorien, and the Witch-king was pushed back and subdued. The Witch-king sat silent in Carn Dûm, rebuilding his armies and preparing for a final assault on Arthedain, last of the Arnorian kingdoms. And much for his pleasure, in the year 1636, a dark plague came forth from Mordor, affecting most of Middle-earth and killing hundreds of thousands. The last of the Cardolan that were hiding in Tirn Gorthad died, and the Witch-king sent Barrow-wights to haunt that place to prevent any further repopulation efforts. This place later became known as the Barrow Downs, the place where the hobbits were captured in the Fellowship of the Ring. And so after a few years, the Witch-king felt he was ready to advance. His attack was sudden, but not unexpected. King Arvedui sent a message to King Earnil II of Gondor the year before, but help did not arrive in time. Fornost fell, and the Witch-king took up residence there in the palace. Meanwhile, a coalition in the south had formed. Earnil sent his son Earnur north with a great fleet, all that Gondor could spare. They arrived at Lindon and joined with the folk of Círdan. Círdan summoned all that it would come, surviving Dúnedain of Arnor and elves of Lindon. Even a company of hobbit archers went to their aid. The Witch-king had grown overconfident, and instead of staying behind his fortifications, initiated the attack. This was known as the Battle of Fornost. Eventually, his army began to fall back, but Earnur's horsemen struck from the north and the Witch-king was routed. He decided to flee to Angmar and the safety of Carn Dûm, but the cavalry, with Earnur himself in the lead, overtook him. Moreover, the ranks of the allies swelled as an army of elves from Rivendell came led by the mighty hero of old, Glorfindel. Angmar was purged of men and orcs, and all seemed lost for the Witch-king in the face of such numbers. But the Witch-king himself came at the last, robed and masked in black and riding a black horse, and attempted to kill Eärnur with his own hands. But Eärnur's horse shied away and fled, and the Witch-king laughed. But Glorfindel came on his white horse and faced with such power the Witch-king fled. He vanished into the shadows and no one marked where he had gone. Eärnur wanted to pursue, but Glorfindel handed him back and made his famous prophecy. He will not return to this land. Far off yet is his doom, and not by the hand of man he will fall. The Witch-king escaped to Mordor and gathered the other ringwraiths around him in 1980. Angmar and Carn Dûm were lost, and so in 2000 the Witch-king began a 2-year siege of Minas Ithil, eventually capturing the place and turning it to his residence. It was renamed Minas Morgul, and a Palantir was sent to Sauron. The Witch-king sent an aura of fear in Gondor, and much of the Ithilien was deserted. Sauron declared himself openly in 2951, and sent 3 of his ringwraiths to Dol Guldur. Then, by lucky chance, the creature Gollum was captured and interrogated. Under torture, the wretched creature revealed that tale of the One Ring, and how it came to be in his possession. Failing to find the ring or the Shire, Sauron sent the ringwraiths to Isengard in the form of black riders. Saruman, already a traitor to both sides due to his transparent lust for the ring, fortified himself in Isengard. The Witch-king did not have enough power with him to assault Saruman in his great fortress, but had words with him. Sauron convinced the Witch-king that Gandalf alone knew where the Shire and the ring was, and so the Nine passed into Rohan in search of him. They came upon the traitor called Wormtongue and questioned him. The terrified man told them everything he knew, that Gandalf had passed through Rohan, where the Shire was, and even that Saruman had lied to them. The Witch-king spared Wormtongue's life, foreseeing that Wormtongue would bring ruin to Saruman. They kept moving west in search of the Shire, and along the way they captured several spies of Saruman, and found charts and maps of the Shire. They came to Sarn Ford and captured the ford and killed many of the rangers that were guarding it. The Witch-king sent 3 ringwraiths into the Shire, while he went east with the others. But they had come too late. The ring had moved into the hands of a hobbit, Frodo Baggins. The Witch-king made camp outside of Bree, and when the hobbits reached the inn, the spies informed him of his presence and organized an attack during the night. Guessing that Frodo would go west, he went with his ringwraiths to the tower of Amon Sul, or Weathertop, where he stabbed Frodo on the shoulder with a Morgul blade with the intention of turning him into a ringwraith. Aragorn fought them off and led Frodo and the other hobbits towards Rivendell, always with the Nazgul in pursuit. Eventually they reached Frodo in the Ford of the Bruinen, but with the combined power of Elrond and Gandalf, the Nazgul were washed away in a giant flood. The Witch-king took the only surviving horse back to Mordor, arriving there in December. He then sent aid to the other 8 Nazgul and they returned in secret. In Minas Morgul, they prepared for a grand invasion of Gondor at the order of their master. On 10th March 319, the signal was given and Minas Morgul was emptied. The Witch-king rode at the head of an army in black upon a black horse, as he had in time of the Wars of Angmar. As the Witch-king passed out of the gates of the Dead City, he sensed the presence of Frodo. He was disturbed, but continued on to Ithilien. With the Witch-king in command, Osgiliath soon fell. Then the Witch-king laid siege to Minas Tirith itself. He sent Grond out first, accompanied in person, so as to be the first to enter the city. 3 times Grond struck the gate, empowered by the sorcery of the Witch-king. The 3rd time the gate shattered in a flash of fire. The Witch-king passed into Minas Tirith but was confronted by Gandalf on Shadowfax. Gandalf forbade him entry, but the Witch-king laughed and put on a show of power. As Gandalf stood resolute before the Witch-king, the Rohirrim arrived. Thus he departed mounting a fell beast and descending upon King Theoden, who led the attack. Snowman, the king's horse, collapsed with a dart in the side, and Theoden was crushed beneath him. But the rider Dernhelm defied the Witch King. The Witch King threatened Dernhelm with a terrible death, but the rider revealed that she was a woman, Eowyn, and the Witch King remembered the words of Glorfindel. He hesitated, but then moved forward. Eowyn decapitated the fell beast, but the Witch King rose and struck her down with his mace, breaking her shield arm. Then, the hobbit Meriadoc Brandybuck stabbed him in the back of his leg with a blade of westernness. Then, Eowyn rose and drove her sword through where his invisible head was. The Witch King gave a great and horrible wail, perishing at last. The reason Merry's stabbing is so painful for the Witch King is the origin of the blade, given that it was a blade found in the Barrow Downs and made in the Kingdom of Cardolan with the purpose of fighting the Witch King's armies. Tolkien clearly states, "No other blade, not though mightier hands had wielded it, would have dealt that foe a wound so bitter." So the prophecy of Glorfindel was fulfilled, for the Witch King did not fall at the hands of a man, but at the hands of a woman and a hobbit. With his defeat and the coming of Aragorn II in the Black Ships, the Battle of Pelennor Fields was lost by Sauron.